Meeting of the Board of Education. A moment of silence and pledge with Amanda Pickett.
Awesome.
Good evening. March is Women's History Month, so for our reflection, I encourage folks to take a moment to reflect on the women in their life that have helped them, guided them along the way. I was going to read a poem by Amanda Gorman entitled We Rise. I will not do her words justice, but I do encourage you all to, there's YouTube, check it out. Her words are amazing, and that poem, I think, sums up women's history really well. So take a moment of reflection. And the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice.
Okay. Fire evacuation announcement. In the unlikely event of a fire, you can go out the two back doors in the chamber and out to the parking lot, or you can go out these doors to the side of the chambers, take a left down the stairway and out to the parking lot. Kathy, can I have the roll call, please?
Mrs. Pickett?
Here.
Mr. Ryder?
Here.
Mrs. Akri?
Here.
Dr. Kalnin?
Here.
Mrs. Cushman?
Here.
Mr. Janitis?
Here.
Mr. Kober?
Here.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Here.
Chairwoman Riley?
Here. Okay. Board guests, Mr. Drezek.
Thank you, Chairman Ryland. Tonight we have very special guests, and I won't ruin the formal announcement, but I would like to welcome our athletic director, Corey O'Connell, and Enfield High wrestling coach, Jason Flynn. And I will let them do the formal, and I won't ruin the surprise, but I will say, because I know you're all going to have comments to say, and I may not get a chance to say it afterward, how extremely proud I am of this young man, and couldn't be a better representation of Enfield High School and everything that we stand for. So. Nobody knows what we're congratulating you for yet, so I'm going to let them say it because I won't steal their thunder, but he knows how I feel about him. So, Mr. O'Connell.
Thank you, Mr. Drezek. Thank you for having us tonight. Part of my job that is the most satisfying is when we can recognize student-athletes for great accomplishments. Keontae here not only is a great member of our school society, he's done outstanding things on the wrestling mat. Just like Mr. Drezek, I won't ruin the surprise, I'll let his coach do it. Again, I know him from the outside, and he's an outstanding member of Enfield High School and what a student athlete should be. So with that, I'm gonna let Coach Flynn give you some accomplishments of Keontae and fill you in on his accomplishments.
Thank you very much. First, I'd like to thank the Board of Ed for taking the time to recognize this young man. I'd like to thank Corey O'Connell, our athletic director, for providing us with everything we need, the administration at Enfield High School, and then our trainers who keep us healthy on the mat so that we can go out there and compete. Our bus drivers, for anyone who's been around wrestling, it's early mornings, it's long nights, it's 5 a.m. bus trip, getting back at 10 o'clock at night, so we couldn't do it without our bus drivers. And then our parents, some are here today. Right. And then all the supporters of the wrestling team. So some of Keontae's accomplishments over, we'll say 4 years, but his first year was that COVID year where we couldn't actually wrestle. So this is really done over a 3 year period. His career record, he has 95 wins and 17 losses. This year he was 44-4 on the year. And that's only in 3 years. He's a 2-time All-State wrestler. He's a 3-time All-Conference wrestler. He was the 2023-2024 CCC tournament champion. On top of outside of wrestling, he has made honors or high honors in every quarter of his high school career, so he's a tremendous student. Into this year, some of the things that he's accomplished. So Enfield High School wrestling records. He has the most wins in a season at 44, so that's since combining the two schools. He has the most tournament wins in a season. He won 8 individual tournaments this year. He is the first Enfield Eagle to win the Class LL tournament this year. He's a 2-time place winner. He took 4th last year, and he's a champion this year. He's the first Enfield Eagle to qualify for the New England tournament, and he did it twice. He qualified last year, and he qualified this year. He's the first Enfield Eagle to place in the New England tournament. He took 5th this year as a senior. And then lastly, and this isn't the This is the largest of the accomplishments, in my opinion, is he's the first Enfield Eagle to win the Open Tournament. So he is a state champ. Last year he placed fourth, this year he took first. What that means, being a state Open champ, you're one of 50. There's 50 285-pound state champs in the United States today. Bear gets to be one of them. Sorry, we call him Bear. Yeah. Bear gets to be one of them in the United States. He's one of 14. He's one of 14 kids in the state of Connecticut who can claim they are an Open champ. So there's 14 weight classes. He's one of 14, and he's one of 8. In the entire history of Enfield wrestling, including Raiders, Falcons, and Eagles, there's only been 7 other Open champs. He makes 8, so he's one of 8. And he's the first Open champ in almost 20 years. The last one was in 06. So it's with great honor and pleasure I present to you your state Open champ, Keontae Crawford.
Speech?
No.
No. All he does is talk in the halls. All he does is talk, talk, talk in the halls.
I know.
He's usually not shy.
I know.
Of course he will.
I've answered questions.
Sure. I turn it back on.
All right. Well, who wants to go first questions? Ms. Pickett.
So, Keontae, I don't know if you remember, but we met way back, I feel like, on the track field. There was a track and field like youth event that you were helping out at, and I remember meeting you. I remember meeting you at the Meet the Candidates night. So to me, that does speak to your character, not your talent that was spoken of so highly. I don't know many of those awards, but just seeing the charisma and the support, it's obvious that they are prestigious and well-earned. But hearing that you're also a scholar, also, I think is important. So my wonder for you is, what are your plans, and what are you up to after in high school and after?
After high school, I'm planning on attending Castleton University to achieve my master's in exercise science, so I can become a physical therapist, because I just like kind of feel bad for our physical trainers at our school having to deal with all the kids all the time. So.
Well, I wish the best of luck to you. I know you'll be a success. It's obvious that you work hard at everything that you do. So great job. Also, thank you to the staff. I really love that you thanked the whole village that it takes to make things work. So thank you to everybody that makes it work, and enjoy this moment.
Thank you. All right, anybody else? Go ahead.
I just want to say congratulations. We're very good friends with the Diazes, and we're with them most weekends. And Pablo we've not seen Coach Diaz in a long time because he's been at wrestling meets. And I remember when you went to New England's, we were waiting to hear to see how you did. So it's quite an accomplishment. I'm very proud of the fact that this is the first Eagle. Own that. That's a great accomplishment for you. And I can't wait to see. So will he get his name up in the wrestling room at Fermi? Excellent. I will say, I do remember seeing you on Meet the Candidates night. You came up for food with JMO, and we were chatting for a while. And I think you were even talking to Superintendent Drezik, because you were your football season, and you were going to be doing the Route 5 rivalry game. So on top of that, you know, thank you. You're a well-rounded student, both on the field, on the mat, and in the classroom. So thank you, and congratulations.
Go ahead, Ms. Acree.
Keontae, congratulations. Congratulations on winning the state Open Championship. Also, great job in being an excellent student, okay, for your academics. That's really important when you're in a sports career. You have to have something really great to fall back on. And keep up the good work. Good luck at the university next year. Great job.
Go ahead, Mr. Genitis.
Coach Flynn, thank you for carrying on a strong tradition from both high schools. There's some giants that were preceded you. And Bear, no Iowa, Iowa State? Come on. If nice
could,
job.
Huh? I could, I would.
Nice job, though. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? You want to go? Good. Okay. So I just want to say congratulations. Way back in the day when I was a student athlete, I know it takes a whole heck of a lot of dedication and time and your parents to back you up and your friends and your coaches. I am I think we all are. Well, I know we all are. And I am very extremely proud of you for being an exemplary athlete and a scholar. That's an amazing accomplishment. And I wish you well in your future. I know you're going to go some serious places.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know I'm not letting you off the hook. You're quiet now. As Ms. LeBlanc mentioned, we had a conversation prior to the Thanksgiving Day game, and I shared with you what my feelings were on that. And Bear was the one in the group who looked at me and says, oh, don't worry, Mr. Drezik, it's personal. So this is also personal. So just so you know, you're not getting a bunch of lip service from the adults in the room. On Saturday, this February 17th, I got a text from your AD that just said, and I'll read it, and I never do this on camera. Your boy Bear won the first ever Eagle wrestling state champion, and my response was that's my guy, he's getting a parade. So you might want to talk to the new guy, but you should get a parade, my friend. Well, congratulations, buddy.
All right, anybody else? Good. All right,
thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Awesome. I mean, this is a very tough act to follow. So, Mr. Digg and Ms. Milton, I hope you guys are prepared.
Well,
I know you are, but you know.
Don and Michelle are here.
Okay. Is this on?
Yep. Is it red, bright red? And you're good.
Okay. Mr. Digg and I are here today to talk about two more of the accountability index indicators. These two indicators are for post-secondary preparation and post-secondary readiness, so they're numbers 5 and 6. Number 5 is preparation for college and or career readiness. It looks at the percentage of 11th and 12th graders taking courses. And the state is looking to see how many of our students take advantage of rigorous coursework in preparation for college or career. They look at AP and dual credit courses. They look at CTE courses in one of the 17 career clusters. And they also look at work experience courses. The maximum points total for this category is 50. State target percentage is 75%, and in 22-23, Enfield High's rate for this indicator was 91.3%, which earned us 50 out of the 50 points for the indicator. To count towards this indicator, students during 11th and 12th grade have to have at least one of the following, and it's up there, 2 either AP or dual credit courses, 2 CTE courses in one of the 17 pathways, or 2 worst workplace experience courses. You'll notice in the description, it talks about IB courses. Those are international baccalaureate, thank you. We don't have those, so I took it out of my description, but it's in the state one.
Okay. All right, so there are a number of factors that influence this score. You can see in the 16-17, that was the first year of consolidation for Enfield High and Fermi. In the years preceding, you can see there was a decline. That was during the time when there was construction and some of the courses weren't running due to changes in schedule, and students were electing not to take some of the CTE courses during that time because of the changes happening at the high school. Following the high school consolidation, there was a change to an 8-period schedule that allowed for extra electives, and that also allowed students to take more AP classes. Also, right around that time, I believe the year after, there was the change that the Board of Ed began paying the AP exam fees, which also again increased the number of students who were participating in there. The change in schedule also allowed us to expand our dual enrollment options. We have the UConn Early College Experience combined with our AP and some separate courses. We have our College Connections program, which was running prior, but got a big boost after we changed the schedule. And we have been working to expand our college career pathways with CTE State. And also having more electives also increased by opportunities. The schedule increased our opportunities to have pathway expansion, and we were able to receive several large supplemental grants to purchase equipment, which allowed for additional second and third level CTE courses during that time. Kind of looking at where we are in district comparison. This is a list of other Alliance districts within our region. You can see as far as an indicator comparison, that's about where we fall, and we're about a point above the state average for Indicator 5.
Indicator 6 looks at whether students have attained a benchmark score in a college of career readiness. It's the percentage of students passing exams. What they look at for this is SAT, and when they look at SAT, a student only can get credit for that benchmark if they hit the state benchmark on both math and ELA. AP 3 or more, and if they earn 3 or more college course credits through dual enrollment, and all of the course grades have to be C or above. So that's what counts for our students attaining the benchmark scores. It's me.
Sorry.
That's okay. The maximum point total for this category is 50. The state target is 75. Enfield High's rate for this last year was 33.1%, which gave us a total of 22 out of 50 points. ACT is also an indicator that they look at, but we don't have many students, if any, that actually take that exam. If they do, hitting the benchmark would be hitting the benchmark for 3 or more of the 4 ACT tests. So it's a little bit rigorous.
So there's a couple influencing factors here. One is SAT achievement, as Ms. Middleton just mentioned. They need to combine, meet both benchmarks in the math ELA. AP achievement, we expanded from 8 to 20 AP courses. So as you start to add additional AP courses, it sometimes can take a few years to develop the courses. Since student scores hope to follow. Some of the CTE courses actually had a large number of course failures after the pandemic as students returned. Some students had a reduced experience in their first level and then were taking second level courses. And there has been an increase in failures among high need students. There's also been a significant expansion in course offerings. And again, just like with AP, it takes time to build confidence in some of these courses. In comparison to, again, the same cohort of districts around us, we're doing slightly better than average for that. And the state is coming in right around 70 or 44% for this indicator. So there are a couple of ongoing actions that we're taking in order to take and help improve more. The SAT strategies for improving that, they're being addressed through departmental work in English and math. There's been a focus in increasing dual credit participation and outcomes. We have a Connecticut dual enrollment grant. We have one of our community of practices around that today. So we're expanding our CCP and ECE course offerings next year, bringing in, we brought in one this year and 5 more courses for the next school year. We have some interesting courses in that group, including medical terminology, 2 teaching pathway courses, If You Love It, Teach It, Introduction to Special Education, and then we have a photography and digital video, graphic design and production course that were included in that. We also currently have started a consultation and PL support with CREC. We're looking at instructional methods for working with exceptional learners. We contracted this in November. We started sessions this week. It's continuing through the rest of this year and next year to help build up teachers' strategies for helping students who are struggling, but also specifically students who are exceptional learners. One of the focuses of that is using Universal Design for Learning. It's a series of just a systematic way of thinking about how you can make your lessons accessible to all learners. We're hoping to pause some of our CTE courses. If you're on the curriculum subcommittee, you've probably seen me a lot the last few years as we bring in new courses. Kind of try and shift our focus a little bit to completion. So having kids complete a pathway, taking 2 or more courses, and working on focusing on the outcomes and course alignment. And fortunately to do that, we have a grant funding. Again, we're using our Perkins grant funding to help improve this in our CTE areas. That is it.
Oh, well, that was fast.
Trying to keep it quick.
Awesome. You guys rock. Does anybody have any questions? I had a couple questions. Sorry. Oh, then go ahead. Go ahead, Ms. Peggett, go for it.
I'm not surprised by the success of especially Indicator 5. I see Indicator 6 as kind of predictable because it's based on some of the assessment data that we've seen, kind of some of our struggles with, mm-hmm. with that. So I think you've probably heard me begging for a presentation on our program of studies. I think there's a lot to celebrate in these indicators. I think we should be proud of our high school consolidation. I think we're seeing benefits of that. And I think we're truly trying to provide a comprehensive high school with various opportunities for students. And we've seen that in curriculum committee with the approving of courses. So a wonder of me is workplace experience. That term seems different to me. So what courses are considered workplace experience?
Yeah, so we have workplace experience coordinator who helps students who are going to get credit for work that they're, so they would leave during the day, they'd go to a work, they'd complete tasks and assignments through there, and then they receive high school credit back. So Ellen Frost in the Career Center helps coordinate that. So it's generally, it's has to be a career related to one of the federally recognized career clusters. So there's a course code for each of those, and the students can go to work, and then they can complete a series of assignments for it. They need to apply for it ahead of time, but they can do that 2 years in a row, or two semesters in a row to earn their credits.
Awesome, thanks. And then my next wonder is not a question that I even want you to answer, but just I'm excited to hear about the professional learning support at the high school. I think meeting the diverse and unique needs of students, especially at the high school level, is really challenging with scheduling and how do we make it all happen. I'm wondering what we're hoping to see for outcomes from some of that professional learning, how we're supporting the classroom teachers with like what that actually looks like in implementation and like what we hope to see happen in the classrooms. And then I think that also kind of conversation around how do we support the lower grades with that. I think that's just a common need. So excited to see that's part of the plan. I support this work and thank you both for your leadership in that expansion.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Pickett. Anybody else? Okay, so all the questions I had, you may not know the exact number right now, which is fine, but what is the SAT benchmark for math and English?
It is 480 for English, and it is 530 for math.
480, 530 math. Okay, and then I saw on the news the other day that they were moving to a digital platform for SATs.
Yes, they are.
Yeah, do we know when that might come
this year?
Oh, this year.
Next Friday for the high school.
Oh,
I actually was on the phone with one of the testing people at the state I called for a smarter balanced question today, and she asked me to contact her after we give it to give her information on how it went. So it is this year. Yep.
Okay. And they're going to be taking that on their iPads or?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Awesome. Mm-hmm. This is really great stuff. I'm glad that we're totally smoking the first one, number 5. That's great. And then it sounds like from what you have in place and what your plans are moving forward, especially this universal design for learning, that sounds good. I think we'll keep moving. I mean, it looked like we already started to tick up a little bit, so hopefully we just keep on up. That'd be good. Cool.
That's the goal.
Yes. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Well, thank you for the presentation. Appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
Okay. Here, we'll give him a class. I feel bad. Okay. All right. Superintendent's report.
Thank you, Chairman Riley. That's what happens when you don't bring a medal. I'm going to start with our student reps, but before we do, we're going to embarrass them a little bit. And we're both going to do that, I think. We're going to brag on both of them. But we're both notified that our two student reps also participated in actually testifying through a legislative process today. And we have the YouTube video to prove it. But I didn't send it to you yet because I didn't get a chance to. So I will forward that to all the board members so you can see your representatives probably doing a better job testifying to the legislature than I do. So thank you guys for doing that, but also congratulations. And we're extremely proud that you actually had the courage to do that. So thank you.
Yes.
And who wants to go first?
I'm going first.
Oh, she told me.
Hi, everybody. I'm going to be doing the out of school, like the outdoor activities outside of school. So March 16th begins the start of our spring sports. Starting with that outdoor track is having a car wash at Raffia Road Service Center from 9:30 to 2 on March 30th. Buzz Robotics won first place at their Hartford Regional Competition, and this is the first time they've won a competition in 8 years. Outdoor Track is also hosting a Red Robin fundraiser on March 25th, so come out and support. Gardening Club is selling green carnations for St. Patrick's Day. They're $1, and they're selling them from March 14th to 15th, and this is a fundraiser for their club as well. And any teens looking for a summer job, the Enfield Rec Center is hiring.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. For in school, we have a few things as well. Recently, our student equity team partnered with our educational equity team and did a welcome walkthrough on March 6th. So a few parents came down to the school and they just like assessed what components of our school environment were welcoming, some things that we need to change. So we'll see how that implements in our schools. The student faculty basketball game is tomorrow on Thursday at 6 p.m. And the day after that on Friday at 7 p.m. is our talent show. So if anyone signed up for that. Also, our National Honor Society is volunteering at Loaves and Fishes on April 11th. And for juniors, our SATs, as the guest said, are next Friday, March 22nd, and on the iPad, so make sure that all the juniors have their iPads charged and ready to go. Also on the juniors, our prom is March 28th, and it's coming super fast, so make sure that you have everything prepared for that. March 22nd is our Strings Festival, and tomorrow, the 13th, we have a half day. Also, student council nominations for the upcoming election are due the 22nd of March. So make sure that you, if you got a little email from someone that wants you to nominate them, make sure you do that. For seniors, the cookie dough pickup was yesterday, the 11th, and it's a fundraiser. So if you guys have any questions about that, you might want to ask someone that's in their student council. And a reminder for seniors that our scholarships are coming out like every single day. So if you're interested in getting a scholarship, you should probably go to your counselor's office. They're probably gonna be there. That's it, thank you.
Thank you, Izzy, you already mentioned some stuff. So as Izzy said, there's a early release day for students tomorrow, Wednesday the 13th. Students are released early with lunch in order for our staff to attend professional development in the afternoon. JFK will hold their National Honor Society induction ceremony on Wednesday, March 20th. There's information in your packet along with an invitation and additional information. And the last thing I'll mention is, obviously I wasn't at the last board meeting. There was no conspiracy there. As Chairwoman Riley knows, and I think leadership knew, I had a pre-planned commitment to go see my daughter. And I understand there was a lot of board action that evening. I didn't get an opportunity to actually see it in real time. Some of the action you take, I'll reserve comments for a more appropriate time on two of the actions that you took, but I won't embarrass anybody at the moment. But I wanted to at least address, and with the chairwoman's permission, I'd asked if I can just weigh in my two cents on one of the decisions that the board made at the last meeting, only because it was really the first opportunity for all of us to have an open conversation with regards to the SSO program that the board adopted. And obviously, as your superintendent, at least until May, I thought it was appropriate for me to at least share my opinion, because it was really the first opportunity that I had a chance to express it publicly. Some of you know this privately, but I thought it was important for you and members, people at home, to watch, to know kind of where I stood with this. And where I stand with it is 100% in support of it. And I understand that, and I'm not getting into, I understand for some, and again, I wasn't here, it might have been a difficult decision. There might be some of you who weren't in support of it. I certainly understand that, and it's not my job to try to change anybody's minds. But I thought it was important to at least share my perspective for a number of reasons why I am 100% in favor of and appreciate the board taking the, and as well as the council taking the action seriously and resurrecting our program. And I say that as a superintendent, as one of the things, really the biggest thing that keeps me up at night is a lot of things that happen in this job, but there's one thing that keeps all of us up at night is the safety and security of our kids and our staff members. So anything we can do to improve that, I'm always all for. And I also support this particular initiative because we've done it before. And I, along with a few of you, were here the last time we did this. And I also have the scars to prove it because I was in, from its infancy, involved and really, as you recall, one of the people that were directly assigned to help create it, implement it, develop it, and ultimately help oversee it. And it didn't come without controversy 11 years ago either. And I understand that. And I understood it then, and I understand it now. But one of the things we were able to do 11 years ago when we created this program was those of us that were tasked with the creation of it and the implementation of it was to stay focused on making sure it was the best program that we can provide for the safety of our kids and our staff members. And I have the full confidence that we'd be able to replicate that again. It's a product of the environment that we live in now. And I know that, and I understand this is a difficult decision for some of you to make, and I appreciate that. And I understand there are some that don't support it and never will, and I'm not here to change your mind. But I thought it was important for a number of reasons to mention it publicly, because it was really my first opportunity that I missed 2 weeks ago, to let people know that the safety of our kids and our staff is the most important thing to all of us. And anything we can do to enhance that is something that I obviously support. When this was first broached to me, the question was asked to me is the same question that was asked to my predecessor 11 years ago. What do you want? And I want everything I can get to keep our kids and our staff members safe. And that hasn't changed. I mean, and one of the things we talked about, it's the conversation starts with, we would like more SROs in schools. And I know there are people who don't support SROs in schools, and I'm not trying to weigh in on that argument either. All I can talk about is my experience with SROs in our schools. And my experience with our SROs in our schools have been nothing but wonderful for the last 20 years. And when we started this program 11 years ago, that's where it started. But getting SROs in our schools wasn't realistic. And it wasn't because of funding or resources. It was just finding the with the size of our district, it wasn't something that we were able to do. And that birthed this program that we had initiated 11 years ago. And for reasons that I won't look past on, the program was dismantled. When we started these conversations again, I asked, can we get it? Because I also know that we live in an environment that with the fiscal situation that we're in, that you're all aware of, we didn't have the resources to expand on the security program that we have. And let me just say, because I know there's a lot of people watching, my endorsement of this program is in no way an indictment of our current security personnel. They are amazing people who do a heck of a lot more than sit at a door and greet people. They get to know kids, they escort kids throughout the building, they build relationships with kids, with families, with many of you. They're wonderful people. But we're also actually asking them to do things that we didn't hire them for. Through this program and its development and the way that we designed it originally and the way that we anticipate designing it again, there's qualifications in order to be eligible to hold one of these positions. And it's something called a post-certification. What that means is to get post-certified, just like in the teaching world, the state of Connecticut has to certify you. And you have to be a current or former law enforcement officer to get that certification. I've lived through the controversy before where people said, well, they're retired cops, so they're not cops anymore. I don't know about you guys, but I don't know anyone who's a retired police officer who the day they turned in their badge forgot how to be a cop. The same way I don't know any teacher who retires from this line of work and forgets how to be a teacher. Peter, you want to weigh in here? Feel free. Kid, it was a joke, Peter. You can laugh now. So I just thought it was important to share and again, recognize the staff that we have, but given the opportunity to expand on what we currently offer to protect our kids and our buildings and our staff was something that it was a generous offer from the council that I was 100% in favor of. And I understand. And I know throughout these conversations, I think, I don't pick on you, Dr. Jerry, where you had mentioned you would like to see maybe more social workers, more mental health providers. I'm 100% with you. That's why, because the budget that I gave you guys, I do not eliminate one social worker or one certified teaching staff member. But I didn't have enough to include an enhancement to our security program. And this was an opportunity that was presented to us that I, again, I could tell you from two different lenses, not just as a sitting superintendent who would endorse it, but also as your sitting superintendent who lived this 11 years ago. So for those of you who still have and again, I'm not trying to change your mind. If you trust me, even a little bit of iota, and I know there's some up here that don't, but if you do, if you have some anxiety over this program, totally understandable. I would just ask that before you bridge judgment on how we do this here, ask this question a year from now. Because having lived through this once before, if we do it right, like we've done it in the past, these staff members become members of our school community. I remember the controversy when we first hired officers the first time, but I've never forgotten the last day they all worked here and the outpouring from the community when those people were no longer here. And some people that came out to support them were not in favor of them being here in the first place. That's because you and the council trusted us, the people who were responsible for hiring and overseeing it, to do our jobs, and we know the community. So I understand this is not necessarily a popular thing in certain circles, and I get that, but I just didn't want to waste the opportunity to express my support publicly, because I've been asked since this has passed where I stand on this, and I wanted to use this platform to share that with you and the members of the community, and just ask everyone. I'm confident in this because we've done it before, and I'm confident in the people that are here, and I'm confident in the people that are going to do this right a second time. So with that, that will conclude the superintendent's report.
Thank you, Mr. Drezik. Okay, number 8, audiences. All right, thank you. Okay. All right, so during this period, any resident or taxpayer of Enfield, employee of the board, or citizen with an interest in our school system may address the board on issues concerning the school. When addressing the board, the member of the audience will state their name and address, refrain from making personal attacks on individuals, and everybody gets 4 minutes. So, first up is Robert Bukowski. I'm sorry if I butchered the name.
Just leave the Z out, it's a whole lot easier.
Okay.
Robert Bukowski, 21 Francis. Good evening, Madam Chair and board members. Tonight I'd like to address some of the comments that were made during the February 14th BOE meeting, starting at minute marker 1 hour and 14 minutes on the video, in case anyone wants to run home and review the video later. The comments were very critical towards certain people in Enfield that are active on the Enfield Town Square Forum, which actually has a wide variety of both conservative and liberal opinions on current issues. Although I must say that most of the opinions do start off from a conservative perspective. Now, my name was not specifically mentioned, but I have spoken about PJ Day and other controversial issues on the forum. So tonight I'd like to unapologetically restate my opinions on some of these issues. There's absolutely no place in Enfield, in the Enfield school system, for assignments such as Pizzagate for middle school boys and girls. I can only hope that a situation like that will never occur again. There's absolutely no place in the Enfield school system for sexually charged, age-inappropriate library books. And there's absolutely no place in the Enfield school system for Pajama Day. Now, raising money for the Connecticut Children's Medical Center is a good thing. It's a very good thing. But the type of fundraising event is very inappropriate. There are 100 other ways a school district can raise money for charity that do not include teachers, BOE members, students of all ages, romping and frolicking around the classroom together in their pajamas. This type of behavior blurs, if not destroys, the healthy professional distance that should exist between student and teacher. Maybe the solution to this is school uniforms. I don't know. Maybe it's Dress for Success Day. Maybe it's a bake sale. I'm not sure. But it's not Pajama Day. And most certainly, there is no place at all in Enfield for drag shows for children or drag reading rooms for children. All of the previously mentioned issues are issues that certain members of the school board, past and present, and administration have supported and defended. Children need to be protected against the repulsive, disgusting, and morally corrupt attitudes and indoctrinating behaviors of certain present, past school board members and school officials. The school board should be focusing on math, science, English, history, music, art, and gym, and of course, responsible budgeting. The school board should focus much more on STEM and a lot less on woke. And I think I have a few more seconds before I get caught off.
30.
Okay. In future weeks, I'll be speaking about budgeting as well. But it's very important to say that budgeting is about not necessarily grand total of resources, but appropriate allocation of resources. It's very important to see line items because some things may be less important this year and some things might be more important this year. Budgets need to be raised or lowered based on specific line items. Line items that we can track back up to the subtotals and grand totals, and line items that we can see track back down to the both ways, track them both ways. For example, an Excel worksheet with various spreadsheets. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. Next is Sheila Monroe. Whoa, it got quiet in here.
Just put it there, thanks. Good evening, my name is Sheila Monroe, Stacy Lane. I'm back to address my character that was talked about at the last meeting, but to clarify my statement made about using an illness of a mother who is the most gentle and soft-spoken person I probably have ever met as a defense of a Board of Ed member who by his association to groups in town promotes the agendas that take away the innocence and helps corrupt the morals of minors. And I mean minors. The common sense concerns brought before you about PJ Day were twisted. And in this current climate of society, the point was not to demonize the event by which much good monies are raised, but bringing about the discussion for selecting a more appropriate theme. 20 years ago, it may have been innocent, but today it is not. Board of Ed members, teachers, staff, parents, the adults in the room should set a standard to represent and expectations and lead by example. A dress code should be looked at and followed. If you feel good about yourself, it resonates onto everything you do. Meeting a high standard is a part of your mission statement. We heard people talk about it last meeting. My husband is currently teaching at the American Welding Society in Miami. He told me just yesterday that he was speaking to the head of the certification department. She told him that anyone who is not properly dressed is asked to leave. It is a respectable place of business and should be treated as such. Those were her words. We are not preparing students to meet high standards that will require them to gain sustainable, well-paying jobs. First, you represent yourself, and then you move on to represent others. At the last meeting, we also heard the plea from many teachers who took the time to come here and speak about their needs. Anyone who knows me knows I'm a doer. I wanted to act on the behalf of the teachers who spoke out for help, and so today I bring a few items that won't solve the big problem, but to let them know that we value them and appreciate what they do. I did bring pencils, I brought Kleenex, and a box of paper. So, Madam Chair, if you could please let those teachers who came and spoke and asked for these supplies last week, if you could possibly get them to them, split them however you'd like.
Thank you.
My kids have long graduated, but I was a parent, room parent volunteer for over 15 years, helping many teachers. We need to reinstate a parent volunteer program. Teachers can submit the name of a parent who is expected on any given day to volunteer. Parents can be extra eyes, ears, and hands for teachers. They have an equal invested interest. It would help to partnership family, school, and community, which is also mentioned in your mission statement, and bring much needed support for struggling teachers. And congratulations to Keontae. He did a great job and he well represents Enfield. And that's the success we want to see happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila.
Yeah.
Okay. Next up is Maureen Griffin.
Maureen Griffin, Abbey Road. First, regarding the presentation, thank you for providing all those AP ECE courses. My daughter has already taken a few of them and has many more to take over the next couple of years, saving me money in the future and giving her a lot of good engagement to keep her wanting to be in school. I came tonight, I always have something I want to talk about the budget, and when I've heard people discuss it and what they want to do and how they think it should be addressed. Yes, you definitely have a fiduciary responsibility to manage the funds in a reasonable way. And I'm thinking a lot about you, Mr. Cover. Economies of scale definitely apply in many areas, such as supplies and things like that, but be careful applying that across the board, because we're talking about children, teens, kids in middle school that have so many different experiences, and you can't have a one-size-fits-all or say, okay, this is what we're going to provide for this group and make it work no matter how many you get this. You have 40 kids, you do this. There's too much variability in their needs and in their strengths that you have to be very careful to not apply a factory mentality to the schools. And that also, I think, is important to consider when you throw out the idea of just increased class size by 2 or 3 kids and we'll save so much more money. You're undermining the teachers in the classrooms by doing that. You're so many kids nowadays in those classes need extra supports because we are trying to bring the help into the classroom rather than pull the children out. And so that increases the needs that the teachers are managing in the classroom. You bring in extra kids, even if the kids are all greatly behaved, and it's not just special ed kids, it's just all the kids. You have higher number of kids with different levels of engagement. That's a lot of stimulation for these kids to have to focus through. And you can't just ignore that. Let's see. And there's not enough supports in class in the classes as it is now. They can't hire enough paras. They can't hire enough behavior techs. So increasing the class size is just torpedoing everybody and is penny wise, pound foolish. You really need to provide the supports, especially in the primary grades, because if you're not hitting the kids there and picking up on the kids that have the needs for extra supports, you're just setting them up to be behind all the way through, and not just behind, but to feel that they cannot succeed and to not like being going to school because they don't feel like it's a strength. They don't feel good about themselves there. You have to invest in the younger grades much more than is currently done. These kids need it. Okay, done with that.
You got 20 seconds.
Okay. When you say repulsive, disgusting, morally corrupt, think about the fact that this is not a private school. This is not a religious school. It's a public school where there are families of every makeup, children that come from every type of experience, use words that treat those children and families with respect. Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen. Okay, next is Karen Passos.
Good evening, everybody. Karen Passos, Lancer Drive. I have been involved in the Enfield Public School System for over 30 years, mainly at Crandall. I was a volunteer lunch aide, served on the PTO. The last 24 years, I have been employed by Smith Bus, driving Crandall and Barnard. I applaud you, Sheila Monroe, Rob Anderson, Jonathan Grande, Amanda Marquez, Ryan Moore, a.k.a. Winston Smith, on your knowledge and expertise of the Enfield Public School System, considering none of you have children who attend. With that being said, I ask you all to please apply to the countless open positions that are available need to be filled, such as paras, bus drivers, mentors, substitute teachers, many other positions. I believe this would be a huge dose of reality that you all seem to need, to see firsthand what teachers and paras do on a daily basis. Because of all the state mandates, students have all the rights. Teachers are underpaid, and yes, they have a union, but that's not the support they need. We are one of the lowest paid bus companies as well as the lowest paid paras. The shortage of bus drivers, paras, and especially teachers is very alarming. I know this for a fact because my daughter is an elementary school teacher. There are four of you judging and criticizing every aspect of Enfield Public Schools. Please, I ask you again, with all your knowledge and expertise and all the qualifications needed for these positions, please apply for these positions. The main reason I am here tonight is Tina LeBlanc is my sister. Wednesday morning, February 25th, while I was driving my run, two of my parents approached me telling me of the insensitive, hurtful comment made to my sister by Sheila Monroe. I went home and watched the meeting and was shocked and disgusted at what Sheila had said regarding our mother. A few days later, my brother called me because he was approached by a staff member at Stowe. He was told how Sheila Monroe made a hurtful statement to Tina. For the past few, especially last 2 years, I have watched Tina as Madam Chair show compassion, kindness, respect to Bob Anderson, Sheila Monroe, Amanda Marquez, Jonathan Grande, Peter Janitis, Ryan Moore, a.k.a. Winston Smith, as week after week they were verbally abusive to the superintendent, the board, and teachers. Week after week, you were all shown respect and kindness by my sister. If anyone should be ashamed, it should be you, Sheila. Who are you to speak for or about our mother? We were raised by compassionate, kind, respectful, giving parents. When our father had his sporting goods store, he was so passionate about Enfield and the children in it. He made sure any child in this town who participated in any sport always had the equipment, uniform, whatever they needed, whether or not they could pay for it. Tina has the same love and is just as passionate about this town and all the education and the education of all the children who live in it. When our mother was told by hospice that there was nothing more they could do for her but to keep her comfortable, we were all called into the room. Her words were to us, "I am so sorry, I just can't do this anymore." She proceeded to tell us, "I'm sorry, I don't have anything to leave all of you." Being told you're going to die and her only concern was what she can't do for us shows a lot of character, which we all got from her. The rest is too personal. We knew it would be our last day we would have time to speak with her. We thanked her for raising five good, kind, respectful, compassionate, humble adults that meant more to us than any material or monetary thing she could have left us. Unfortunately, Tina had the least amount of time with her mother, being she was much younger than the four of us. Tina has proven to have excellent character, and I want to say, Tina, we are and always will be proud of you. And as I tell you all the time, Mom and Dad are and always will be proud of you. Everyone is entitled to your opinion. It's not what you say, it's how you say it. Instead of coming here being judgmental, critical, prideful, disrespectful, and unkind, try using some compassion, respect, kindness, humility. You may be amazed at the results you will get. Don't be part of the problem, be part of the solution. Do I have any time left?
You've got 22 seconds.
Okay, in 22 seconds, I want to say we as a bus company participate in pajama day. We do not frolic and run around. The excitement you see on those kids' faces when they get on the bus and they know it's pajama day, they read, they do all their work they always do in class. So it is a treat for them to have pajama day. It's a treat for us. I take my job very seriously. I'm very prideful of my job and so are my co-workers. So, thank you. Are you Alicia? I drove Alicia to kindergarten, too.
Okay. That is it for audiences. Number nine, board member comments. Who would like to go first?
Okay.
Okay, Mr. Ryder.
Just a couple of notes this week from Eli Whitney. Anybody that ordered butter braids through the PTO fundraiser that ended recently, they'll be available for pickup at Whitney on Thursday, March 21st. That'll be after school. Also want to send a special congratulations to Jacob in fifth grade and Chase in fourth grade. They will be moving on to the next round of this year's Invention Convention, which took place recently. Also, next Friday, March 22nd, our fourth grade families are welcome to come in for our Influential People and Places of American exhibit. You can join the fourth grade team as they showcase the historical projects and exhibits being made by our students. And that is all I have for this week.
Mr. Ryder, who would like to go? Anybody? Oh, Dr. Callanan?
A few quick words about Head Start. Summer school will run from July 8th to August 1st. Two classrooms will be funded through the state supplemental Head Start funds. A community and self-assessment plan illustrates will be conducted late this spring. A community and self-assessment plan will be conducted late this spring. The purpose of the self-assessment is to, one, initiate the program planning process, two, provide the right services to the right population, and three, support continuous quality improvement. The kids are still on Unit 4 at Head Start. Matter matters. Second step is focusing on friendship skills and problem solving. Ready Rosie this week focuses on the properties of water. In terms of special education needs, five children have developmental delays, eight are speech or language impaired, and nine have autism. The intake process for September enrollment is underway and will continue through the summer. If anybody is interested in enrolling their children, please call the Head Start Family Support Office at 860-253-4717. As far as transportation is concerned, good news is no families are on the transportation waiting list. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Dr. Callanan. Anybody want to go? Ms. Acree?
Good evening. From the desk of Andrew DuPere, he says, save the date and mark your calendars for Wednesday, April 17th at the Enfield Public Library on Middle Road. And rain date, by the way, would be April 18th. We will unveil the intermediate One Book, Three Schools 2024 book and author. And this will take place between 6 and 7 p.m. Come out and participate with staff and students from all three intermediate schools. We will have fun and interactive stations that reflect the themes from the book. More information to come. Be on the lookout for the flyer, which will be going home soon. And just a few additions. The next Barnard Crandall PTO meeting is March 19th. Of course, it's virtually on Zoom, and it starts at 6 p.m. And Crandall families, keep the shoes coming for the shoe drive. Help us reach our goal of 1,000 pairs of shoes collected. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Acree. Anybody else like to go? Mr. Cover?
All right. Thank you, Madam Chair. So I'll be brief. I don't really have any board member comments, but I do want to do a better job kind of touching on some of the liaison updates. So just for Henry Barnard, Spring Picture Day is coming up Friday, April 19th. There's a couple family events that are going to be happening, grade level math and literacy nights, different nights for kindergarten, first grade, and second grade. And there's also going to be three family nights in coordination with the CT Science Center planned. Similar to the math and literacy nights, they're going to be events designed for families to participate in fun science-based activities, and they'll be separate nights for kindergarten, first grade, second grade, and they're all kind of outlined in the Big Cat newsletter that gets sent out to the Henry Barnard families. Just want to highlight, too, that there is a Welcome to Kindergarten night for fall 2024. It's going to be held at JFK on Tuesday, April 16th. On that note, for I know we're going to be talking about it in the policy update, so, you know, for the people watching and for the public, just, you know, there is that change to the kindergarten cutoff date. There was a press release that went out from the superintendent's office regarding requesting waivers. So the period, the window is open now for families that are doing that. And you should be getting contacted by the coordinators at each school. So that's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Colbert. Go ahead, Mrs. Pickett.
All right, I will start tonight with comments. It is Ramadan, so from March 10th to April 9th. It is a celebration and holiday that is reflection, includes prayer, fasting, and time with families. We're going to be talking about calendar later on, but I have continuously asked since I've been sitting up here to have like a backside of our calendar where we can signify religious and cultural holidays and celebrations. I think it's incredibly important because they do have impact on our students, our staff, and our families. So I have great hope that our district has done some proactive support for our staff and students with arranging a prayer space, alternate lunch provisions, and possibly some physical education provisions, testing and assessments, flexibilities, all those careful considerations. So happy Ramadan to folks celebrating. Thank you and congratulate you, Andy, publicly. I think that all happened after, right?
Like, yes.
So I just want to say congratulations to you, Andy. My hope is that we can continue to work together to find that clear system and structure of support for our staff and students and tap into all that talent that we have. So thank you for being willing to step up for us and take that seat. It appears that there continues to be some concerns about our budget. Some folks mentioned it here tonight. I know it was also mentioned at our town council meeting. I do want to just share a couple things publicly that I think is important for everybody to have access to. Ensuring factual information is used for decision making is really important. So just a couple things. With that being said, I do have a question for you, Madam Chair, and I don't mean to put you on the spot, and so we can discuss it later. But I was under the impression that meetings have happened between town leadership and Board of Ed leadership about our budget. So I was concerned when I heard the mayor and others say they don't have our budget, they don't know, they haven't seen it. I just want to ensure that the format of our budget, them having access to it, isn't a barrier that they're facing.
No, can I just interject real quick? So we had a discussion with them to tell them kind of where we were at. At that point in time when we met, we didn't have a final number to give them. And we still have to go to a council meeting and actually present them. So they do not have the actual numbers nor it in their hand unless they were proactive and went on our website and took a look.
Perfect. Thank you for clarifying that. So I'm anxiously awaiting that budget presentation. I will continue to advocate if there's any way we can have joint conversations with the town council about our budget. I think that might be helpful. The other thing that I want to share that per pupil expenditures are calculated with a formula that is publicly available. It's easily look upable. The school state finance organization is a nonpartisan group. And so the conversation of comparing apples to apples and the town covers expenses that we don't get credit for, all of that is false. So when we calculate per pupil expenditure, it is apples to apples. So I encourage folks to check out that resource. Madam Chair, I know I've shared it with you. I'm hoping we can have some conversations about that. The other piece around kind of the partnership with the town, I never want to disparage any of our partners or any of the folks in buildings and grounds or DPW, but it is clear we don't have adequate resources for our buildings. And we have roofs that are leaking, unsafe parking lots, dingy playgrounds, buildings in disrepair. It should be noted that we have some needs that again links to some of the conversations about security. I wasn't gonna really tap back into that, but I would agree that safety and security is a priority. However, it's more than just armed guards outside our school and investments in our school buildings as part of that conversation. I do wanna talk on a positive note about a visit to HMS that I had. I think it's really important that we spend some time highlighting the ways our staff are making lemonade out of truly rotten lemons that we might be giving them. I don't know if anybody has gone into HMS, but you can stand in one spot and touch seven different types of tiles on the floor. It's in disrepair, and I think it looks like our council chambers have recently got a facelift here. So, like, if there's investments that need to be made, I think we need to take a step into our schools and take a look around. But in regards to the staff at Hazardville, I got to visit pause time. They gave me this great presentation of the intentional, dedicated time to building community that they're doing in their school. This doesn't happen easily. It takes leadership support, staff buy-in, and commitment to prioritizing relationships. It is shown to improve attendance for students and staff and behavior. So two things that are necessary to even access learning. This is one strategy. It's an example of how our staff have stepped up in adversity. And even though we might not want to admit it, our elementary schools, particularly our K-2 schools, have suffered programmatically due to some changes in our budgets and structures. So a PBIS coach being removed and the transition space has been a huge challenge for those schools. So I'm hoping to hear more about how we will be investing in those systems and support, aligning those tier one practices, and really investing in those routine structures, expectations as those foundational pieces of Enfield. The other pieces that I wanted to mention, I live very close to JFK, and they have that nice electronic sign that always has the weather on it. I was wondering if there's a way that we could look into how we could use that electronic sign to, like, announce half days, early releases, town events. I think it's a nice, attractive feature that we underutilize. I also know that we're going into executive session about some safety things. I do want to mention some other things that have come up, though, about the signs that might be coming close to ESS. I don't know if we have an update on that. And then I had a family reach out to me, and I go by Stowe daily, and I can't believe I never noticed this. But it's fast on that road, and then there's school times that are posted there. I don't know if those school times still actually correlate with the hours of Stowe, or if those are belong to, like, the school. It's weird times, and I feel like Stowe always has buses and people out there. It would be nice if that was just a permanent school zone that just had school zone hours in it. Last few, quick things. Enfield Little League, they had evaluations this weekend. I think it's important that we also shout out our students. So the high school baseball team supported that and volunteered. That was, I think, my son's favorite part, was seeing those players. There was also an equipment swap. So any family that is playing and has equipment to donate or needs equipment on opening day, that will be continuing. The readathon is happening at Enfield Street School, and Parkman has a Red Robin fundraiser on the 14th, a fundraiser ending for their butter braid and jelly roll on the 15th, and Spirit Week next week. And I think the rest of my comments are about our agenda. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Pickett. Anybody else want to go? Okay. Go ahead, Mrs. Cushman.
I just wanted to take the time to remind our community about Screenagers, the film series that's presented by the ETC Mental Health and Wellness Coalition, which teaches about the different ways social media and internet usage are impacting our youth. Part one was shown last week. Part two, entitled Next Chapter, will be shown on Tuesday, March 19th from 6 to 8 at the JFK Middle School. Part three, titled Under the Influence, will be shown on Tuesday, April 2nd from 6 to 8 p.m. at the Enfield High School. I really encourage our community members to attend and gain the skills to protect and empower the youth around you. For more information, contact Tessa at 860-253-6382, or you can contact her by email at Ridel, at enfield.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Cushman. Anybody else want to go? Go ahead, Mrs. LeBlanc. Okay, just a few things. First of all, Andy, I want to formally congratulate you on your appointment to superintendent. It is well-deserved. I appreciate your time in Enfield Public Schools in various roles, and I believe you understand and know Enfield. Mr. Drezik, I want to congratulate you on your new appointment to Old Saybrook, and I want to point out the fact that you the news release said 32 candidates, so that is quite an accomplishment. I'll have more to say to you prior to your last meeting, but it should be congratulated on the
improvements and vision you had for Enfield Public Schools, both when you were deputy superintendent and superintendent. So I just wanted to give you both a shout out. I also wanted to mention Ramadan. Happy Ramadan to our public schools family celebrating. And I wanted to educate myself more about what exactly was Ramadan. And like Ms. Pickett said, it's a month of intense spiritual rejuvenation with a heightened focus on devotion, during which Muslims spend extra time reading the Quran and performing special prayers. March is Women's History Month. It's time to celebrate women and the difference they have made in our history and culture. Women have made important advancements in arts, sciences, and mathematics, as well as their studies in the medical field, and even our very own vice president is a woman. Let's see, security guards. I was able to fill in for Mr. Ryder in the Joint Security Committee meeting on Friday, and I asked some questions, and I am able to share this publicly. I confirmed with that committee. So one of my concerns was, what was the program going to look like? I knew what the program looked like in 2011 because I was here. I never thought I had to vote on security guards three times since I've been here, and I never thought I would ever have to do that again after last time. That's neither here nor there. But one of the things that I think is important is for us to get the information out about what they can expect from the security guard program. I know many of the parents that are involved might not even have kids that are in the schools anymore, but they'll be in the same uniforms as the school security officers, and they did really ingrain themselves in our school community. I believe that, you know, some kids as a reward got to eat lunch with them. I think that it's very easy, and it's a very scary vision when it comes to our schools and imagining a school, an armed officer in there. What can we expect as parents? Ms. Riley had some really good ideas about letting people know about what to expect as parents ahead of the school opening. So it was a good conversation there. And to Mr. Drezik's point, I believe when we did the armed guards the first time, there was no state legislation. So since then, there is a state legislation that we have to follow. I think the only thing that I would like to mention, and I listened to Councilor Santanella's comments from the last meeting, is there's a narrative out there that this was a request from the Board of Education, which it was not. These conversations were happening, and then it turned into, as we got closer to budget, then it was discussed. But this wasn't the Board of Ed saying, hey, we have a problem, we need this. And I think that we just need to stick to the correct narrative. I want to mention the per pupil spending misinformation that came out of the town council meeting last week. All districts are put on the same level playing field when they are getting their per pupil expenditure figured in, so that, you know, some budgets include buildings and grounds, some don't, but it's kind of like they're stripped, there's exclusions, and then they're comparing apples to apples over every school district. So to imply that our numbers could, that was definitely misinformation. I'm gonna save that one. Okay, this is the last time I'm going to speak on this. Politics has turned ugly when I can't sit up here without somebody mentioning my mom who passed. And not only one meeting, but two meetings. And you said what you said, because it's in the minutes, and it saved her posterity all over YouTube. Nobody's family, if we're sitting up here, should be included in any type of dialogue. I saw it get really nasty, and you guys were up here, and nobody ever attacked anybody else's family in the audience. You just don't do that. And you know, there's comments, oh, they deserve it, they put themselves out there. Yeah, we can be questioned on our political differences, but you're questioning our character, and you're assuming we support things. All of us, we're like being lumped in one group. And I will say it again. This is the last time I will speak on it. And it definitely shows even more this week than last that it shows more about your character than mine. Thank you to my sister for coming. I'm sorry that it upset my family. I know we miss mom and dad. We have had so many important life moments since they passed. They would be great grandparents. They would have seen their kids go off to school, graduate from college, be productive adults. And they would have loved every single one of their grandkids that they didn't get to meet. So I appreciate the family support on this, and I know how hard it was on the family to hear it. I know how hard it was even for my own kids to hear it, because that was a very low blow. So thank you again. I love you, and thank you for always telling me how proud they are of me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. LeBlanc. Mr. Tinnitus?
Okay, as far as the public comments, Robert, at least in my opinion, thank you for your thoughtful comments. Sheila, I like the old idea that we used to have a long, long time ago with PTOs and parents coming in and volunteering and to help in the lower grades. That would be lovely to see again if it's not going on. Maureen, you're spot on when you say we shouldn't be having factory curriculum or education. I hope we're not going down that road. I know some school systems have. And with state involvement, we may be going down that road, like it or not. Also, you mentioned class sizes. A few kids here or there really aren't going to make a huge difference. I hope we never have to go back to the sizes that we had when I first started teaching, because those were big class sizes. But it all comes down to the art of teaching, and any good teacher can handle an extra couple of kids. As far as your comment on the reading in the early grades, I would strongly suggest in the curriculum committee that we have something where the kids in grades 1 through 3, maybe even take it out to 4th grade, have to have a mastery of reading. And if they're falling behind, then we've got to come up with some solution to have extra help for them in class. And I would hate to say it, but I mean, if it means going to a reading teacher, if we still do that, or missing a recess or an art class or a phys ed class or something like that, or after school program. But these kids have to have the ability to read by the time they're in 4th grade, because if they don't, you can almost peg probably with a 90% success rate of kids who are going to have problems in school. Reading is just the utmost importance that we can have. Karen, you came up here and spoke about your sister and everything. Everybody is entitled to their opinion, whether you like it or not. You singled out a list of people who don't have kids in school. If you look at this board of ed, what do we have, 5 or 6 people sitting up here that don't have kids in school? We may have had them, but we don't anymore. I got the opportunity about a week and a half ago to go over JFK and sit with Andrew, and got a really nice tour of the school and everything. And I have to say, sitting up here as a board member, I couldn't believe the things I saw in that building. It's just, it blew my mind away. I perceive teaching after 38 years of always changing and everything, but what a change that's taken place over there. The equipment that they have, the various classes, the programs, I was really shocked to see it all. And then listening and talking with Andrew, I was very impressed with that man, very impressed. And the last thing, again last night, who do we have to talk to about those darn lights at JFK after 10 o'clock? Somebody shut them off, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tinnitus. Does anybody else want to go? I think, all right, I'm next.
Okay, all right, so Mr. Drezik semi-embarrassed them, but I wanted to elaborate on our student representatives. They testified live at a general law committee public hearing. They testified for proposed Bill 199, and this bill would require tobacco retailers to be educated on how nicotine affects young people when applying or reapplying for their license.
So I really want to congratulate, well, one left, but congratulations on stepping up and going forth, because that's not an easy thing to do. So very proud of you. Okay, so.
Are you done?
No, okay. I got a lot ish. Okay. A lot ish. Okay. All right. And then they stole my thunder with Buzz Robotics. So congratulations to them with their first win in the last 8 years with their robot Optimus Rhyme. They are going to district championships at the Big E on April 4th through 6th. So if you could go to that and watch, I'm sure it would be a hoot to watch. They are having a fundraiser on the 21st of March. It's a pasta supper at St. Bernard's Church to raise money for the admission fee to that. We're going to have to talk later about, in the finance, when we have the finance committee, about moving bonds from short-term to intermediate-term bonds to take advantage of the better interest rates. So we'll just need a consensus on that one later. The reading supports, I know that we do that. I don't know if everybody has access to it, but I do know that if kids are having a hard time reading, we do have extra supports for that. But when we get, if we have curriculum, we can get a better outline of exactly how that works for you. The per pupil thing, yes, we give all of our information to the state. And then they take that information, all of it, buildings, grounds, curriculum, all that stuff, and they come up with a number. And they have a formula. And that website stuff that Amanda provided is great. However, it's a little concerning that when you go on to different pages within a state website, they give you multiple different numbers for per pupil. I've seen 16, I've seen 18. So while those are great, it would be nice to know what the source of truth is for that. Like, we have at work, we've got like one program, and like that's the source of truth. So if we knew where that was, that would be helpful, because it's disheartening when you see different numbers and like people are talking here and there and we're not on the same page. Then I want to talk about Hazardville Memorial. First some updates and then something really cool. So International Read to Me Day is Tuesday, March 19th, and I have a list of different times here that I can share with you guys. They want volunteer readers to read a story to a student or do an activity with a student on the story that they choose, and there's a bunch of different times that you can go. So if you guys want to sign up, you can reach out to Ms. Fitzsimmons, and I'll give you the times. There is a local author coming to visit them, Jamie Deanian. I'm just bad with names. Like, I can't remember them and I can't ever pronounce them, so I'm very sorry. And she is going to be visiting on March 12th with all of the grades. This is really cool to listen to. Vision of a Graduate Parent Focus Group is going to be held in collaboration with Eli Whitney on March 20th at 5:30. And I did see in the Crandall newsletter that I get that they're also doing that at Crandall too. I don't have a date though. So that's pretty cool. Because as you know from hearing before, that Vision of the Graduate is going to carry them from kindergarten all the way through graduation. So that's pretty cool. And then on March 6th, they had a literacy night, and 250 people attended. And they did reading and writing activities, and they got some new books to take home. And they could sign up for library cards there. So I thought that was really cool. And they got to learn about multilingualism. And then the other thing, was like a week or so ago, they have this thing in Hazardville. It's called Pause Time. This is really cool. And I really think that if we can get these two phenomenal teachers to share this with the rest of our K-2 schools, this would be a really awesome thing. So the two teachers that headed up, one is Teacher of the Year, Amber Venudos, yep. And another teacher over there who is actually the Curriculum Associates Extraordinary Educator. She's one out of 32 nationwide, and her name is Kelly Rossetti. I got to hang out with them. And this pause time is really cool because the kids stay in their classrooms, and then the teachers, all of the teachers and staff, special ed, everybody, they switch classrooms and they get to be with another teacher that maybe they don't ever get to be with. And they all, they read a book or they have a book read to them through the iPad from another teacher over at Whitney or just another teacher in the school. And they read the book, then they have questions, focus questions about the book to talk about whatever theme the book was. They're all the same questions. So all the teachers have to do is just either read the book or present the book, and then they talk with the students, and then they do a craft afterwards about the book. So, and everything meshes like in sync with each other, because I went to three different classrooms throughout the process, and it was kind of funny because every classroom that I went into, I started with the book, and then I went to the next classroom and they were already talking about the book with the focus questions. And then when I went to the last classroom, they were making the party hats because the book was out about a dog with party hats. I can't remember the name of the book, but it was great. And so this has, they have data that shows that this has increased attendance. It has increased morale. They have less behaviors in the classrooms with the kids. And all of the kids know every single adult in that building, so they all have a comfortable feeling, you know, in there. And the kids just love it, and the teachers love it. So I asked them if maybe they could, like, come and present here, but more importantly, if we could probably get that going in other buildings, because it was a great collaboration, and everybody seemed to love it. Their attendance is like almost 100% on those days. So I thought that was cool. All right, I'm done talking. Okay.
Just one more comment.
Yes, go ahead.
Just one more comment, because we don't agree too often. Amanda, when it's nice that you brought up the Ramadan thing. I know when I taught history, I used to take a week out and do comparative religions. And I would love to see something like that done on a small scale. You can do it from anywhere, 3 to 5 days, and hit the five major religions of the world. And it does open up a lot of eyes with kids.
All right. Anybody else? Okay, let's move on to unfinished business. 10A, policy revisions, second readings. Mrs. Cushman, do we want to start with 5111?
Sure. The first of the revised policies to consider is policy 5111, age of initial entrance into the school system. This policy is being revised to comply with the current state statute, in which the age of eligibility changed from 5 years of age on or before January 1st of this school year to 5 years of age on or before the first day of September. It's effective July 1st of this year. So I would like to make a motion to approve the second reading of policy 5111 as revised.
So moved.
Second. Motion made by Ms. Lank, second by Ms. Pickett. Any discussion?
Madam Chair, I just want to propose one minor amendment to it. Just in the added text, the word exception, I believe it should be plural exceptions with an S, just for understandability of that. So it would read, exceptions to this policy will be in accordance with board policy 5112, ages of attendance, dropouts.
Okay. Any other discussion?
Thank you.
Okay. So then we need a vote on the motion as amended.
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Ryder.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Pickett. Any other discussion? Okay, so sensing none, roll call vote, please, Kathy.
Mrs. Pickett?
Yes.
Mr. Ryder?
Yes.
Mrs. Akri?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
Yes.
Mrs. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
Yes.
Mr. Kober?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. Mrs. Cushman, 5112.
So the ages of attendance, dropouts, these were actually two separate policies proposed by CABE. There was significant content overlap between them, so we recommend a revision that combines the two policies into one. So I'd like to make a motion to approve the second reading of policy 5112 as revised.
I need a motion.
I'm so moved.
Sorry. Motion by Ms. Pickett.
Second.
Second by Mrs. LeBlanc. Any discussion?
Okay, sensing none, roll call, please, Kathy.
Mrs. Pickett?
Yes.
Mr. Ryder?
Yes.
Mrs. Akri?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
Yes.
Mrs. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
Yes.
Mr. Kober?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, 9321, Mrs. Cushman.
Yep. Time, place, and notification of meetings. Based on the approval of the revision to policy 9325.2 regarding meeting adjournment being no later than 10 p.m. local time, the recommended revision to this policy would align it with policy 9325.2. So I'd like to make a motion to approve the second reading of policy 9321 as revised.
So moved.
Need a motion by Mr. Kober. I need a second.
Second.
From Mrs. LeBlanc. Any discussion? No. Sensing none. Roll call, please. Kathy.
Mrs. Pickett?
No.
Mr. Ryder?
Oh, yeah. All right. Can we?
I had a quick question. I'm sorry we jumped to vote before we went to discussion. Sorry. I had a note here about simple majority. Phil, where did we put that in?
Oh, that's in 9321.
Yeah, so that's now in the second reading of 9321. It's the text got put in green if you're looking at the PDF. But in the paragraph adjournment of meetings, it'll read, meeting shall adjourn no later than 10 p.m. Extensions and time of adjournment may occur by simple majority vote.
Okay. No, I just want to make sure that we have that in there. All right. Yes.
Mrs. Akri?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
No.
Mrs. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
Yes.
Mr. Kober?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. Mrs. Cushman, 9325.2.
Order of business and meeting conduct. There are several recommended revisions to this policy with the overall intent to better define the terms of the agenda as well as to establish clear expectations for all who attend and are able to participate in board meetings. While it maintains input from all stakeholders, it specifically directs that all charges or complaints shall be submitted through the proper chain of command as outlined in Board Policy 1312. I would like to make a motion to approve the second reading of Policy 9325.2 as revised.
So moved.
Motion made by Mr. Kober. I'm going to need a second.
Second.
By Ms. A. Cree. Any discussion?
So, Madam Chair, I'm just going to add. So one of the benefits, I think, with this proposed thing for the order of business is we're creating a separate agenda category for liaison reports. I think that's going to facilitate board member comments a lot. I know a lot of us wear multiple hats, and we're reporting on multiple things, and then we're adding our own goals and expectations. So I think this will clearly delineate what topic we're on. This will also align with the streamlined end time at 10 p.m., and I think it sets better parameters for the audience comment and board member comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kober. Any other discussion? Okay, sensing none, roll call, please, Kathy.
Mrs. Pickett?
No.
Mr. Ryder?
Yes.
Mrs. Akri?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
Yes.
Ms. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
No.
Mr. Kober?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. 9325.3. Mrs. Cushman.
The meeting and parliamentary procedures. The recommended revision to this policy includes a reference to and heading of other methods of voting to better align with the actual practice of the board. I'd like to make a motion to approve the second reading of policy 9325.3 as revised.
So moved.
Motion made by Mr. Kober.
Second.
Second by Mr. Ryder. Any discussion? No discussion. Sensing none. Roll call, please, Kathy.
Mrs. Pickett?
Yes.
Mr. Ryder?
Yes.
Mrs. Akri?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
Yes.
Mrs. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
Yes.
Mr. Kober?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Awesome. Okay. Unfinished business B, discussion and action, if any, regarding the 24-25 school calendar, which was tabled on 2/27/24. So I need
a motion to put it back on the table.
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Ryder.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Pickett. Any discussion? Show of hands, all in favor?
Of what?
Of putting it back on the table.
Oh.
Okay. Nine in favor and none against. Okay. So do you, would you like to speak about now a fifth edition?
No, but I will.
Okay. Thank you.
So the last time I was here with having this discussion, the board had requested different versions of the calendar in order to make, because there were some obstacles in the original one we had put forth. So in your packet, there are four drafts that were previously shared with the board. As I explained to leadership, is that typically, as a past practice, but not as a policy or anything contractual, we notify the teachers and administrators union of any potential calendar adjustments prior to the board taking vote. And we did receive some feedback, which in turn is the result of draft number five, which you have in front of you this evening. So ultimately, the decision on the calendar is the sole discretion of the board. You met your obligation to solicit feedback, but nowhere does it say you have to take the suggestions and actually adhere to them. That's still obviously your decision. The only thing that's set in stone is that I have to present a calendar for proposal to you in January, and then we follow your policy, which you've already waived. So you have five drafts in front of you. My understanding from the last conversation was prior to today's update, the consensus was more focused around draft number four. And I don't know what the will of the board is with regards to number five. The only difference would be a later start date for everyone from four to five, which would then push a later ending date between four to five. So essentially having your 181st day on June 9th with a firm graduation date of June 13th, which is in draft number four. And then number five, that obviously gets shifted to a 181st student day on June 11th with the firm graduation date on June 17th. Really the difference you have to be cognizant of is snow days and weather, particularly as you get into June. And there just would need to be an understanding by, I don't know, someone who would be responsible for communicating these things, that any of the dates, whether it be the last day of school or potentially a rain date for graduation, there would just need to be clear communication that nothing would happen on Thursday, June 19th because of the federal holiday for Juneteenth. So the version four gives you a little bit more flexibility in June in the event you have a bad winter or obviously inclement weather for graduation. June 5th gives you a bit of a later starter date, or draft five gives you a bit of a later starter date. Okay. But it's up to the will of the board and what you choose to adopt.
So I have a procedural question then for Kathy. Because there are some people that wanted one, some people that might want four, and there's some people that might want five. So should we do like a hand vote for all of them and eliminate two and three? Or
you could do whatever you want, really.
Okay. So are you guys agreeable to doing like a hand vote for one and then
you could poll the
five?
Board right now.
We
could,
can we have a discussion?
Calendar discussion?
Yeah, we can have a calendar discussion. Yep. Go ahead, Ms. Pickett. You seem to
Look at you catching on quick. So, Chris, I appreciate you taking a moment to clarify process. Since I've been a Board of Ed member, I've provided feedback on our calendar about wanting a backside, about like thinking about how we schedule conferences. So I think kind of reminding about process, and this is a yearly duty, and I think that's important for the public to hear too. Like, this is one of our yearly duties. So thinking about how we do this is important. So ensuring that we do get feedback from staff and from families, scheduling for breaks, half days, when school starts, all of that is challenging. So I will say I particularly like version five. I was really worried about version four's back to school date for staff. So this version five seems more doable for staff to be able to come back and have more time off in August. I also particularly was not in favor of any version that had a half a day on December 23rd, because that just to me didn't make any sense. So I am good with version five.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Pickett. Go ahead, Ms. LeBlanc.
I'll go ahead. I like version five. Okay. It seems to cover all the bases. Okay. I know it's a really wonky year.
Yeah.
So I know this calendar in this particular year was very challenging. So thank you to all who worked on it and got this ready. So I support version 5.
Okay. Go ahead, Ms. Acree.
No, I was just going to say support version 5 too, okay, since it was more comfortable for the teachers.
All right.
You know, when you sent out the email.
All right, go ahead, Mr. Cover.
So I have a few general comments, and then, you know, if we narrow down to one or two, I'll drill down on that. I know I personally, and I think I indicated in previous meetings, I was definitely a fan of the start date on draft one, just being that students are going back after Labor Day. As mentioned, I think that half day on December 23rd, that only one in that week is probably not a good idea. You probably have very poor attendance on that. Other than that, I think that was a very good calendar. I know last time we indicated, too, that we're excuse me, a little late coming to the ball game with this. So a lot of neighboring districts have already approved their calendars. So I started looking at what some other towns were doing. In particular, I liked what Summers school district is doing. So their back to school date for students will be September 3rd of 2024. Their back to school date for staff will be August 26th. And what they're doing is loading that first week of 5 professional development days. And then throughout the school year, they're having a lot less disruption for PD days because they're having the bulk of it on the front end. So I know that's something I would like to see rather than all our drafts seem to have just 3 PD days on the front and then October, November, December, February, they're a little more spread out. As also was indicated with drafts 2 and 4, that back to school date for staff being August 20th or August 21st, I think that's a little rough, especially if you know, staff's doing summer school, stuff like that. You know, I know we're trying to get students out earlier in June, but now if you're cutting the back end of summer, you're also interfering with family vacations and events and stuff like that. So, you know, I would be in favor of draft one with maybe just amending that December 23rd date, dropping that. December draft 5, I don't see any major issues with, of course, just, you know, as a parent, I think it would be kind of silly having kids go to school Thursday, Friday in August, you know, probably during a heat wave and then going right into Labor Day vacation and coming back on the 3rd. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Cope. Go ahead, Mr. Reiner.
I also support draft 5. And one thing I'll say about starting school on a Thursday, it seems inconvenient, but having the kids kind of, especially at the younger grades, kind of get that getting to know you stuff out of the way on Thursday and Friday, then they have that 3-day weekend for Labor Day, and then they kind of hit the ground running on Tuesday the 3rd, I think helps a lot of our younger learners get a feel for the building. They get to meet their teacher. It's 2 days where they're learning, you know, where to go, where to eat, where they sit. So to kind of get that out of the way and then hit the ground running in September, I think makes sense. I also support draft 5.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Ryder. Anybody else want to go?
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Genitis.
Piggybacking on what Scott just said, those 2 days, Thursday and Friday, those are the 2 days you learn every kid's name and then forget half of them when they come back next Monday.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay, so I guess what I'm hearing is we're going to go with 5 and we'll vote on number 5. Okay? So any other discussion? No? Okay, so sensing none, let's do...
We need a motion
to approve draft number 5 of the 2024-25 school calendar.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Ryder, seconded by Ms. Pickett. Any more discussion? Okay, so sensing none, roll call, please, Kathy. Okay.
Mrs. Pickett?
Yes.
Mr. Ryder?
Yes.
Mrs. Acree?
Yes.
Dr. Kalman?
Yes.
Mrs. Cushman?
Yes.
Mr. Genitis?
Yes.
Mr. Kober?
No.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Chairwoman Riley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. New business. We have no new business. So let's go to board committee reports. Curriculum committee.
The next meeting is March 21st, next Thursday.
Thursday.
So, Madam Chair.
Yes.
Just a couple of things. Peter, you had mentioned the reading intervention. I think that was some of our curriculum discussion that we had 2 meetings ago. And I think that would be helpful maybe at some point to have some discussion here about our tiered interventions and supports. I also imagine that some of that might be impacted by budget. So I think we have had some of those discussions in curriculum, but kind of really thinking about what that looks like. The other thing that I just want to mention, and I wish I would have mentioned it earlier, is I did get some feedback, and I really want to be careful about how we talk about high need students, and especially our special ed students. I never want families or students to ever feel like they're a burden to us. So hearing families say, like, we keep hearing high needs and the burden on our budget, I also think looking at those budget websites will help you understand that we do get lots of funding around special ed supports, never enough. But I want every student and family to know you are never a burden. It is our job to provide equitable education for all.
Yeah, go ahead, Ms.
I wanted to say the same thing. I had it in my Board of Ed member comments because Ms. Pickett shared that feedback with her. I think that when it comes down to funding and the budget situation we're in, it's almost a sense of making sure that a high need student has every resource they have available to them, and then all the students. So again, I want to reiterate what Ms. Pickett said. Special ed and parents who have a high needs or special ed students should not feel like a burden to the school district. I can't say that with enough passion. My sister, one of my sister teaches special ed in Salem, Mass, and those students are near and dear to her heart and leave a lasting impact, and so do the families. So I don't want anybody to think that they're a burden, because that is further from the truth. Every student that attends schools in Enfield Public Schools is valued.
I would echo that. I mean, I hope nobody feels that way. I hope that's not what we're getting at.
No.
We're just trying to, you know, emphasize the part that the state needs to, they need to help us, like they promised. That's all. You're definitely not a burden. Yes?
Amanda, I do remember the meeting. And I remember all the tier one, twos, threes, and all that stuff. But I also remember sitting there thinking, I don't think it's enough. It's not enough. And I think we have to make a more concerted effort. I mean, when we identify those kids, probably in second grade, where you'd have to start zeroing in more heavily, and then definitely, you know, third grade, you just can't let them go on. Because we've done that too often for too long in education. I forgot the other thing I was going to say. Okay, that's it.
Well, maybe we can, once it rolls out, that new reading curriculum, once it actually really gets going, because I think it focuses a lot on phonics and such, which is a big help in reading. So maybe we can have, you know, presentation brought out once we get that new reading curriculum up and moving.
And the other thing too is with the number of kids that we're getting with not speaking English, that's another reason for being more concentrated in reading. Of all the subjects, it's got to be the top one.
All right. Anyone else? That was a good curriculum discussion. That was good. Okay. Finance and budget.
So, Madam Chair, Finance and Budget met on March 4th. We'll have expenditures for February to talk about later on the agenda. And our next meeting is April 1st at 5 p.m.
Okay. So then with the next meeting being April 1st, we have one more Board of Ed meeting in March. So do you guys want to talk it over with, you know, your caucus, and then have Dr. Callan come back to Finance and Phil and Gina come back, and then to tell MML investors if we want to go ahead and move bonds from short term to some bonds from short term to intermediate to take advantage of the interest rates. Are you guys cool with that?
Is there any urgency to make the decision?
Because
April 1st?
Yeah, kind of. Okay. They really want to move.
I'm going to be real honest. If a financial advisor is making a recommendation that we do this, my knowledge of what to do there is very slim. So.
Okay. Nope, that's good. So I would just say talk it over amongst, and then just have Dr. Callan bring it back, and we'll have Mr. Coburn and Ms. Acree bring it back, and then they can go ahead and tell them to proceed as whatever. Cool. All right. Policy committee.
Our next meeting is March 19th at 5:30.
Okay. Leadership. The last was March 5th. We went over budget and agenda items. And I don't know when the next one is yet, but it'll probably be next week sometime, I'm assuming.
Joint facilities, that go, you want to do it?
The next scheduled meeting is Thursday, the 14th.
Perfect. JFK Building Committee.
They canceled their March 7th meeting, and the next meeting will be March 21st.
Scott, do you know how much longer that building committee will be?
I don't, but I can ask.
Okay, cool.
I ask Scott a question.
Yeah.
Are they addressing any of those problems in the building as far as the hinges and the drains and stuff like that? Or are you, is that nothing you do?
We can ask. I don't know what specific ones you're referring to.
There's trouble with the drains, and there's trouble with hinges, and I guess just call up the lead custodian. He'll give you an earful.
Okay. Maybe we can, I can give you like a list, because I have heard some concerns.
Cool.
All right, awesome. Thank you. All right, Joint Security Committee. Last, you want to do it?
Well, they met on Friday.
Yep.
The next meeting is April 5th.
Yep. And then in that meeting, we discussed the next steps, basically, what's going to happen next. And then with the SSROs, but also with the signage, it's still with DOT, but they've given DPW some options on different types of signage. So I guess they're going to weigh in on that, and then they'll go from there. Okay? Yep. All right. Enfield Mental Health Committee.
Okay, so I'm going to read the data from the surveys that were filled out by the administration in the district. So this is going to address the needs of our students and also the administration, what they would like to see, you know, more expansion of the program. The behavioral health challenges confronting our Enfield students are manageable, but the volume is not. In both primary and secondary schools, there is a variety of behavioral problems, including oppositional defiant behavior, depression, and school aversion manifesting as chronic absenteeism. But the most frequently encountered problems are inattentive, hyperactive behavior, and anxiety. This is true both at the primary and the secondary school levels. Social workers, guidance counselors, and behavioral health techs were all found to be highly effective in helping students to manage their problems in a school environment. The problem is there are not nearly enough of them. There also needs to be continued trauma training for staff to best support student and families. A conversation must begin between the Enfield School District and the town's state legislators to procure more resources and funding to meet the mental health needs of our students and their families. The school system must also secure stronger relations with Enfield's civil society, such as Enfield Kite, the medical community, and the religious community, to enhance its access to badly needed support and resources. One administrator stated that a helpful aid would be also having a directory of local area mental health supports. A major challenge is engaging families in the management of their children's mental health problems. This is particularly important in terms of connecting families to resources outside of the school system for purposes of diagnosis and treatment, which are beyond the purview of our school-based personnel. A mechanism must be found to coordinate care between the school system and the community healthcare system, including behavioral health care, while at the same time respecting the right to privacy. Currently, there is no meaningful interaction between school and community. As evidenced by the high incidence of behavioral health problems in the primary schools, it seems likely that such problems start well before school entrance. These problems should and must be identified proactively by screening and managed in a timely manner, ideally before school admission. Otherwise, the school system will continue to be overwhelmed by the sheer number of seriously troubled children. And lastly, the frustration and fatigue involved in managing often out of control behavior is taking a toll on our teachers. Teachers must have access to resources that will support and promote their own mental health as well as prevent burnout.
Thank you, Ms. Sacre. Go ahead, Ms. Black.
Thank you so much for the work that you're repeatedly doing on this committee. I do want to say you had mentioned it's an issue getting resources outside of the school system. And what's unfortunate about mental health is oftentimes people don't reach out until they're in crisis, right? So then they can't wait a month to get in to see someone or 2 months to get in to see someone, because it usually takes someone to really kind of break down to say that they are having a mental health issue. Little ones don't understand what's happening. I really appreciate the feedback on this, and it sounds like you've established a really good relationship and created a partnership with Enfield Public Schools admin. I appreciate you really sharing this. I do want to mention that I think it's unfortunate that your committee seems to be targeted of an FOI request. I am sorry, because this is nothing but good and positive work. And I think both Dr. Kalnin and Ms. Akri have said we need to understand what the needs are in our district before we can try to make any motions to try to fix them or offer supports. The frustration and fatigue is real. We need more supports in our buildings. And the mental health of the teachers is just, or the staff in general, is just as important because they're dealing with their own. We don't know what a teacher goes home and does in their own life. They may be taking care of a sick parent. Their children may be sick. Maybe it's just a family caregiver. It's definitely trying to find a balance to make our students and our staff feel supported. So I appreciate this work, and I look forward to updates. This is excellent. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? So a couple things. Can we get an explanation of trauma, what it is, like, because that's like a pretty, I don't know, it's a easily definable word, but it has many different things that it could be. So hearing about trauma in the schools, it'd be helpful for me at least to better understand what that is, and like what kind of training is that, like what does that involve? So if I could just maybe sit with you guys and like learn about it, that would be kind of cool, because I don't know exactly what that entails. And then the other thing is a directory of local mental health resources.
Well, that was administrator did. I thought that was interesting that they put that down on there.
When I was on the council and COVID happened, I got together with a bunch of lovely women who were awesome to work with. And we put together a sheet of everything, of like COVID resources, like where you could go to get food, when we were doing it at the schools, where you could get masks, numbers to call if you were having trouble. And we had put it out into the community, and it was like up in doctor's offices and stuff. So I'm wondering if we could somehow compile just a list of local mental health resources. Not like we would be endorsing them or anything, but it would be a list of them so people would at least know where to go first, and then maybe if we could put it on our website, maybe, if that's not some law that we can't or whatever, or give it to the town manager, maybe they could put it on the town manager's site or something. But I think compiling a list would be good, because then at least give people a starting point. And if I could help in any way to get that together, just let me know. Because it did seem to help when we had that directory back when COVID was going. Yeah.
Go ahead. I was just going to say, so I love directories and access. Part of the issue of creating directories is as soon as you create a directory, there's like a new thing that pops up or something that goes away. I would share that if schools and families are looking for updated resources, 211 is one site that like the state pays for folks to update and keep updated. The other is Connecting Connecticut Children and Family to Care. So it's called connectingtocarect.org. And that's a behavioral healthcare website where you can put in your town and resources are listed. So that is connectingtocarect.org. That's a good, quick fix, not a local, but it does have your local services.
I was going to add to your point, the PLA, when they did, they graduated last May, they have to do a community project. And one of their community projects was something they created called the Enfield Hub. And it's got that information, like 211. It's got resources, but it also has a lot of the community resources. And it does even have like local play groups, how to sign your kid up for Enfield Little League, how to kind of sign your kid up for soccer. So that's just a resource. If you guys wanted to look into that, check out the Enfield Hub and then Chairwoman Riley too. And then you can see if you can take stuff from there and share it based on what you're saying.
Maybe we could put just links on our website to those places. Something like that. I don't know. Yes, go ahead.
Just two quick comments. I think the directory is a really great idea. People need to know where they can go for help. But the limitation is the waiting lists are incredibly long, no matter where you go. And also what's very frustrating is the turnover rate within organizations such as CHR is really, really high. So that I hate to be a downer on this, but a patient starts to develop a relationship with one therapist, and after 3 or 4 months, that therapist leaves. So there's this constant turnover that's just, I think people have to be aware of that going into this, that there's bound to be a waiting list, and there's also a very high turnover rate. One of the things that people can do is they can start their search with their pediatrician. Pediatricians may be able to grease the wheels a little bit, and also a lot of the trend now is for pediatricians to become more involved in management of behavioral health issues. So for example, if a patient comes to the pediatrician with depression, that doesn't necessarily mean that patient automatically should be referred out to a therapist. The pediatrician now has the ability to co-manage those patients using an online service, the name of which I cannot remember. It's been a long time. But it's now possible for the pediatrician to work with a psychiatrist in co-managing a patient in his own office. So that's just another option that patients should consider.
Thank you, Dr. Callinan. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mr. Genetti.
Just a thought. I don't even know where we could start doing this, but it might make some sense if we could get a program going where we can contact a lot of these teacher colleges and anybody that's going into teaching and see if we can get them to start offering some classes. I mean, you go in for your methods classes, your whatever subject it is, you learn all about the subject areas. But things that we're talking about that we might want to do as a board, boy, wouldn't it be beautiful if it took place at the college level?
That's interesting, too. Okay. Anybody else?
No?
Okay. And Enfield Cultural Arts, Tina.
I just have a couple of quick updates. They are starting their summer concert series, and it's definitely a more robust group of bands that they got in. I do have to mention there's going to be a yacht rock group. I love yacht rock. there's some country. There's the Brat Pack. There's some folk. The Brat Pack, if you're mid-70s to late-70s, baby, you'll love them. One of the things we talked about was if there was a way to get student involvement at the band shell. So when they do their spring and concerts, whether it's chorus or band, would they be able to do something in the band shell? It's a way to connect the arts to our students, and it would be kind of like the same thing where you could come and set up a blanket, because most often the only people that see our students are relatives, neighbors, but it would be a chance for community members to come out. I don't know if it would be like an Enfield High, just Enfield High, or if it could be JFK. I'm not sure on the sound there, but I thought it would be a really good discussion to have since they're going to be having their spring concerts. I do know that weather is a factor, but if we could continue those discussions, that would be great. I do want to give a heads up that the concerts are going to be on Tuesdays again. So for those of us that were on the board last year, we had the concert during our meeting. Remember that? We couldn't even hear each other. It's going to impact our following meetings, June 11th and June 25th, July 9th and August 27th. So I think I had mentioned it to Charlotte because I saw her the day after the meeting that we had bumped up our meeting time. Was it 5? It was sometime, but
five.
I think Janet and Dr. Jerry still had to park far. So that's something we're going to want to.
I cannot attend.
That was very, yeah. I was telling Charlotte that you could hear it on the TV when you were watching us. So we might have to do something about those meeting dates because they did confirm them. They were going to be on Tuesdays. One of the things, the mayor was in that meeting and he had said he went to social services and there are photography projects that have been put up in the hall, and he thought they were phenomenal, but his thought was, and I agree, that we would love to see our student art in more public places, and he didn't know that the town hall would be the best place, but I suggested the council chambers. I mean, I know we have lovely pictures of Enfield, but perhaps we could have some of our student art showcased in council chambers if they wish, but I'm looking around as I'm saying it. But I definitely, the ECAC is definitely dedicated to trying to get into our school community and be a partner and help showcase their talent throughout our whole district. So that's the only thing from ECAC. It's a very enjoyable meeting. I think they're open. You should come if you have time. I can let the board know and let you know because they're doing great things in the town of Enfield.
Thank you.
Tina, yes. Have you considered the library?
For concerts?
No, for displaying art.
They do have some there.
Oh, okay.
I guess there's a big display in the Pearl Street Library of an Enfield High artist right now. So they do use the libraries, but we have so many ways to showcase the art in our buildings around town. That was the point. So.
How about all the chicken places in town now?
There you go. Well, it's interesting because the 99 has old sports photos up. You know, it would be great if we could either update those or get some student art.
Very cool. Anyone else? Okay. All right, moving on. Approval of minutes. Special Board of Ed meeting minutes, February 27th, 2024.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Ms. Pickett, second by Mr. Kober. Show of hands in favor. Probably should have said discussion, but I think we're good. So there is 8 in favor. And abstentions or against?
Abstention.
Abstention, 1, Mr. Janitis. Okay. Regular Board of Ed meeting minutes, February 27th, 2024.
So moved?
Yep.
Second.
Moved by Ms. Pickett, second by Mr. Colbert. Is there discussion? I just want to say thank you, Kathy. That was a monster to put together. Thank you. So show of hands in favor. Show of hands in favor.
Thank you, Kathy.
9 in favor, none against. Okay. Approval of accounts and payroll, Mr. Colbert.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So we do have expenditures to review for the month of February. Finance Committee met on March 4th to review financial statements for the month of February year-to-date and examine various documents related to finances. A review concluded there was nothing significant to report to the board. Motion is, I move we accept the superintendent's certification as follows. I hereby certify in the month of February, total expenditures amounted to $7,174,299.24, broken down between payroll totaling $5,037,644.75 and other accounts totaling $2,136,654.49. All payments have been made in accordance with the approved budget and are properly accounted for within the books of accounts. Copies of approval for check invoices are properly documented, certified by business manager Lorena Cisneros.
Second. Motion made by Mr. Cobra, second by Ms. Pickett. Can I have a show of, discussion? No, show of hands in favor. 9 in favor, none against. You have another one?
Yes. As stated, the Finance Committee met on March 4th to review financial statements for grants and Head Start expenditures during the month of February year-to-date and examined various documents related to finances. Our review concluded nothing of significance to report back to the board. Motion being, I move we accept the superintendent's certification as follows. I hereby certify that in the months of February, the total grant and Head Start expenditures amount to $570,767.18, broken down between payroll totaling $410,426.74 and other accounts totaling $160,340.44. All payments have been made in accordance with the approved budget and are properly accounted for within the books of accounts. Copies of approvals for check invoices are properly documented, certified by Lorena Cisneros, business manager.
Motion by Mr. Cobra.
Second.
Second by Ms. Pickett. Any discussion? Show of hands, 4 in favor, 9 in favor, none against.
And there are no line item transfers for this period.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Ryer, do we have correspondence and communications?
Just a reminder that we did have one invitation in our packets. The National Junior Honor Society, of course, is at JFK Middle School. National Junior Honor Society celebration is on March 20th at 6:30 p.m.
Thank you. All right. Executive session. We have executive session for matters related to security, so I need a motion to go into executive session.
So moved.
Made by Mr. Cobra.
Second.
Second by Ms. Pickett. And I have a show of hands, 4 in favor. 9 in favor, none against. And thank you very much. Have a wonderful evening.